This is Mike Plaisance with the Republican and Mass Live, and we are at Gateway City Arts in Holyoke, Massachusetts, for an art exhibit of the works of Robert Templeton, Bending Towards the Truth. And with us today is Mr. Templeton's son, Kevin.
Hello there. Welcome.
Tell us about this exhibit, Mr. Templeton.
Well, my father was inspired to do this after covering the Detroit riots for Time magazine. He felt that there might be a need in the future to put down on oil these people who struggled for civil rights.
All right, thank you. Let's walk around here and see what we got. There's 35 works here?
I think there's 34, 35.
What medium did your father prefer to work in?
He liked oils the most, but he also worked in pastel, charcoal, and watercolor. Did a lot of portraits, my dad. That was his bread and butter. And wasn't his favorite thing, but that's what paid the bills.
You did President Jimmy Carter, did you not?
Yes, I actually modeled for that. That's my torso and hand. But don't tell the curator. Must riots continue? Well, if conditions are bad, riots happen. Try to make things better for everyone. Slow process.
What was it that drew your father to this subject matter in particular, folks like Frederick Douglass?
Well, he loved history, but he was an ardent supporter of the civil rights movement. He didn't like the treatment that people were getting. He thought the laws were unjust, and it was a soft spot in his heart.
Now, these over here were sketches that he did of the Black Panthers trial?
Yeah, my father worked for Walter Cronkite as well. Actually, the Panthers are opposite you.
These
are the mock-ups for the Detroit riots that ended up in Time magazine. This was done on the street in the morning. He wasn't there during the worst of it, luckily. I don't know if he would have made it out. It's pretty bad.
You mentioned that he encountered folks who grabbed his sketchbook from his
room. A few people threw bricks at him. He was inside a station wagon, had the window down so he could take pictures and do some sketching on the steering wheel. And there was a lot of hostility. Plenty of firemen and emergency personnel trying to put out the fires and help people who had been injured. These are the Black Panther trial sketches from New Haven, Connecticut. Late 1970 into 1971. The Nixon administration had blocked all cameras and reporters from the courtroom. But my dad sketched on napkins, he sketched on his hand, and he did the rest from memory and from what he could get.
So he sketched on his hand?
Mm-hmm. And on napkins. The judge caught him once and almost sent him to jail. It was a guy named Judge Mulvey. These are the Panther trial lawyers. Gary on the left, Markle, the state prosecutor in the middle, and Rohrabach on the right. She was part of the defense.
What did the judge say when he caught your father?
He said, if I catch you doing that again, I'm throwing you in jail. Yeah, it was that guy. J. Edgar Hoover and the Nixon administration had decided that the Black Panthers were the greatest threat to America at the time. So they were intent on doing something which they felt was proactive for the health of America.
Is that
Bobby Seale?
Yep, that's Bobby Seale. I believe he's still alive. I think he lives out in California, maybe Oakland? I'm not sure. He's still around.
What did your father say about covering this exactly and getting an order from a judge? That's pretty serious stuff.
It was a little unnerving, but he was just trying to do his job. He would sketch what he could. Then Walter Cronkite would fly him via helicopter from New Haven to the offices in New York, CBS News, and he would finish his sketching sometimes in the helicopter or at the office when he got there. This was a mock-up of a model for a larger work that never came to be. It's a bit grim, but those were rough times. A lot of people were getting killed. Here's my dad's portrait of Dr. King.
Yeah, this is...
Dr. King's wife supplied the photograph that she thought would be best for my dad to use.
Oh, yeah.
This was in 1972, 1973, and he got to work on it. I think it took him about 3 years in between other commissions to finish it.
Now, did I read correctly? Dr. King had planned to sit for your dad? For a portrait, or?
Well, I'm not sure. I think the person that worked with my father, Dr. Benjamin Mays, who was a mentor to Dr. King, might have made the suggestion to Dr. King that he sit down with my dad and get his picture done. But I'm not sure.
This is striking.
Yeah, it's a good one. It's my favorite one, and it's his wife's favorite pose.
How big is that? What are the dimensions of this? Do we know?
I believe it's 84 by 96, 7 by 9 feet.
Wow. Look at the eyes.
Yeah. They follow you around. I guess that's the mark of a good portrait painter, if the eyes follow you around. And my dad certainly was that.
It's interesting, these folks, like Ralph Abernathy.
Yeah.
They're not as perhaps prominent as Dr. King. And
they worked really hard at it, too. This was sketched in Abernathy's home, I believe in the early 70s. Dr. Abernathy was also interested in the idea of preserving the history, and he liked the idea of a portrait collection. Same with Asa Philip Randolph. This was done about 6 months before Randolph's death in his home, I believe in Manhattan or the Bronx. I know it was New York City.
And this is charcoal?
Yes. And there's an oil of him across the way.
So your father did painting, he did charcoal sketches, he was also a photographer.
Yeah. Oh yeah. He was the company photographer in his army. From his army days, platoon, is that the word you use?
Yeah, this is cool.
Yeah, that's Eldridge Cleaver, great writer and fighter. He helped form the Black Panthers in the late 60s, not the 68.
What's the screen?
It does signify him busting out. Next ones are Bobby Seale. Perhaps these should have been grouped with the other ones over there, but I like what they've done with it. Yeah, May 1971. All the convictions were thrown out. There wasn't enough evidence. There's another one, Solidarity Today, a protest march in Washington, 1968.
This is just a multimedia.
Here's a gentleman that my father met through Ralph McGill, who we'll talk about later. He was president of Morehouse College, and he was a mentor to Dr. King. And he liked the idea of getting a portrait exhibit together.
Benjamin Elijah Mays?
Yeah, he was instrumental in getting this collection done. He opened his contact book, because a lot of people wouldn't sit for my dad. They didn't trust a white artist. What's this guy doing, you know? Should I trust him? So Dr. Mays was instrumental in creating this. What happened to that?
That's interesting. So some folks wouldn't sit for you.
Right. My dad never told me who, but he said that some people just wouldn't do it. This is Roy Wilkins. He's the leader of the NAACP. There we go. That's a nice portrait. Looks very happy and calm. Dignified. It's a dignified show.
The detail is incredible.
Yeah. Well, look at my dad was all about the details.
Look at the necktie.
Mm-hmm.
And the buttons.
Mm. Did more than 10,000 portraits, my dad. Probably more than that, but nobody really knows. He would just turn them out. Here's Rosa Parks. My father drove to Michigan, up to Detroit, in a snowstorm to paint her.
No kidding.
And she was working for a congressman at the time. Why does his name escape me? Anyway, the congressman was all dressed up. He thought that my dad had come to paint him. But my dad was like, no, I've come to work with Rosa.
I'd rather meet the icon.
Yeah, the guy was a little miffed. Somebody accused him of sexual harassment recently. Why can I not remember his name?
The congressman, maybe?
Yeah, he's a guy from Michigan. I don't know if those allegations are true or not, but he was all dressed up expecting to be painted, and was a bit disappointed.
That's fascinating. What did your father say about Rosa?
She couldn't believe that anybody would drive 1,600 miles to paint her portrait. She just couldn't believe it. You want to paint me? Why?
I would love to have met her.
Yeah, I like this portrait because this is the only one I've seen of her without her glasses. My father never liked to paint people's portraits with their glasses on. He said, please, take them off. Conyers, yes, Congressman John Conyers. That was the man who she worked for at the time. And here's Dr. Mays again. Longtime foe of bigotry and segregation.
That's a very statesmanlike
book. Big proponent of education. Was definitely a threat to the established order. There's Booker T. Washington.
Oh, yeah.
What this show does, Mike, is commemorate people from the late 1800s to about the mid-70s. Yeah, from the Niagara Movement, the late 1800s until about 1970, 75. Dad also gave Dr. Abernathy an extra portrait of himself for his family.
Now, a portrait like this, how long would it take your father to have done this, you think?
If he could concentrate it all in one shot, concentrate and get it all in one shot, 2 to 3 days.
Really?
He was fast.
Wow.
Yeah, he used to refer to himself as last of the red hot portrait painters. And he was right.
He just kept, look at the seriousness.
Yeah, and sometimes he would have to use a projector if he was under a lot of pressure and had a lot of projects going on, but he could draw without it.
So your dad must have been somebody who always had his painting stuff and sketch books with him, right, in case something came up and he would work.
I didn't know him when he was young, but later in life, he was able to separate work and leisure. But yeah, you're probably right. He had his camera with him much of the time, and he had sketch pads with him. I believe he got started when he was about in earnest when he was about 12 or 13. Then his high school principal noticed that this guy had some talent, and you could tell what it was he was drawing, unlike some people, and helped him apply for a National Merit Scholarship, which he got, and he was sent, he was able to go to the Kansas City Art Institute and study there. One of his teachers was Thomas Hart Benton, the American realist, who had no patience for people who couldn't draw.
Yeah, that
which is one of the reasons the school let him go.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. There's Johnson. My dad never actually had a sitting with Johnson. He tried to get one, because my dad was friends with Hubert Humphrey. That was Johnson's vice president at the time. But yep. Johnson wouldn't do it. Everyone hated Johnson by that time. He was an irascible old son of a, I won't say anything. But he got a lot done. He was one of the most effective presidents we've had. And this, my friend, is Ralph McGill. Ralph McGill was editor of the Atlantic Constitution and a staunch foe of racism and segregation. He was totally into the idea of desegregating America. And my father had a commission by the paper to do his portrait. This was in serendipitously shortly after the riots. So my father explained to Mr. McGill what he wanted to do as far as a civil rights portrait collection is concerned. And McGill was interested in the idea and called his friend Dr. Benjamin Mays, which turned out to be the collaboration that my father was looking for. Mm-hmm. So all of these guys pitched in. Ralph McGill, the conscience of the South, they used to call him. He would get death threats. His mailbox was blown up twice by the Ku Klux Klan. And that's how it went back then.
Did your father get threats?
Yeah, we used to get hate mail. It proved that we were onto something.
Silver lining kind of guy, huh?
Well, we got noticed, I guess. These are the creators of the NAACP. Oh yeah, well everything for my dad was a silver lining because he grew up in the Depression in the Dust Bowl in Iowa. Could have died. He watched his sister die for lack of medical care.
Really?
Yeah, it was rough. This is my favorite, a montage of Gandhi and King. Well, of course, the Big King portrait's my favorite too, but I like this one a lot. Shows a lot of action.
Yeah, I'd like to.
Yeah. Many people are in there. And there's Malcolm X, who had a terrible time when he was young because of the system and people messing with his family. His father was a minister, preaching desegregation, preaching self-reliance, made him a lot of enemies, and I believe he was murdered. But the state wouldn't prosecute the murderers. They said it was an accident. And the insurance company who held his death policy said it was a suicide, so they wouldn't pay out any money. Then people came around saying that his mother, who also held the same beliefs, was unfit to raise Malcolm, and it broke up the family. So I'd be a little angry too.
Yeah. Now, did your dad ever meet him?
No. This was done from a photograph. I'm not sure where my dad got the photograph. This is way before the internet. It's more difficult to find photographs to use. But he found one he liked, and he decided to do it in blue. Malcolm X in blue.
I think that's my favorite one.
Yeah, it's awesome.
And with that, Mr. Templeton, we're going to call it a day. I appreciate your spending time with us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mike. I hope everybody enjoys the show.